match. Thanks, everyone. Sunday, one of my favorite students, as our master ceremony. I really appreciate you all coming. I know a lot of people are going to be joining us. I think we're fighting the weather as well. I would like to be outside myself. This is a great opportunity. You'll see later in my comments how important I think it is for universities to be involved in innovation and entrepreneurship, and in particular, the role that universities can play in local economic development. So it's not really only about starting small businesses, the interaction of government, business, as well as university environments. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that today. And if you have any questions afterwards, I'll be around for a while.
Actually, yeah, keep us
going. Run through this. We have Katie coming in after the fantastic guy. We'll try to get you guys back into the process of meeting these great companies. It's fabulous, and I know many of them, so I hope we have a chance to meet people from places like Snag Job, Confluence Coffee, Hourwise, and Blue Triangle, and on and on. Great conference. So let's talk a little bit about how to catch fires as an entrepreneurial ecosystem. And the challenge is that everybody wants to be Silicon somewhere. Right? There's Silicon Valley. Did you know there's Silicon Andes? Right? There's Silicon everywhere. And it's hard to do. It's really very difficult to do. In fact, Hoffman Foundation has done research that suggests that there are, in fact, a few areas of the country that have traditionally been startup hubs. And if you go all the way back to the mid-1980s and you look today and you try to adjust for growth, the ones that were big in the mid-1980s, still big today. There are a few that have kind of caught up as small players, but places like Silicon Valley, New York, Boston, Massachusetts are really, really strong entrepreneurial environments. But now we have places like Boston and Boulder, Colorado that have emerged as being terrific startup hubs as well. We're going to talk a little bit about what it takes to be that kind of place. And universities play a big role. You play a big role. You'll see yourselves represented in this review. So what does it take to create a great entrepreneurial ecosystem? There are a number of factors that all have to work in concert for that to happen. And now, you can have a little more of this, less of that. Think of it like mixing a cocktail, right? You can have different ingredients, but they all have to be there to call it an entrepreneurial ecosystem. And the first one at the top of my list is risk-taking culture. How many of you think that our education system is set up to create risk-taking? Exactly. From the time you're in elementary school, through middle school, and high school, and college, grades matter. The standard for performance is perfection, straight A's. What's important in the world of innovation and entrepreneurship? Redescribing or redefining failure of learning. The process is itself iterative. And yet, we're in an environment where people worry a lot about whether they have a 3-2 or a 3-4, which you probably got by taking an easier professor. So that environment is one that we're working against. And what's terrific at places like VCU and at VCU and at University of Richmond, there are moves afoot at the very most senior level of the universities try to change that and create what I think of as a culture of experimentation. And that's something we need because so many of you can be so terrific in an entrepreneurial, innovative role, whether it's one of your own creation or one you join, or it's a large company that you're helping them grow through your product development, or a company you start from a greenfield position. But I don't want you to be discouraged by having 3-2, there are an awful lot of very wealthy 3-2 entrepreneurs, 2-5 entrepreneurs, a few people government support. Why do you think government support is important? So here's the really crazy thing. When you're trying to establish an entrepreneurial ecosystem, you have to have companies at the seed stage, the very earliest stage of development. And that seed stage development is one which requires funding at some level. The problem is, it's a really bad business to be in. The successful entrepreneurial funders, those that run venture funds focused on seed rounds, have portfolios that have 20 to 40 companies that they've chosen from hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of submissions to curate 20 to 40 fundable startups. We don't have a huge ecosystem, do we? And that's one of our challenges. And that's where the government can play a role. Because the government can step in as a civic component and help turbocharge the beginning of the process with access to funding in a number of different ways to apply that. Next component is industry collaboration. We're blessed to have a number of very, very large companies in the Richmond metropolitan area. In fact, per capita, an unusually high concentration of large companies and mid-sized companies and prominence. Those companies play a prominent role, and it's two ways. One is they can fund into the entrepreneurial community, and the other is they hire out of the entrepreneurial community. We'll talk a little bit about the impact of entrepreneurial ecosystems on those incumbents. Next, abundant capital. Well, this gets back to the first issue, but it's not just about seed funding. It's also, those of you who are studying entrepreneurship know that funding is done in tranches. Effectively, you have A rounds and B rounds and C rounds. And unfortunately, ecosystems like Richmond, Virginia, and it's not at all unique Richmond, Virginia, cities our size, don't have a lot of professional capital. So when you get to the point of needing A rounds and B rounds, you have to go to other cities to get it. The venture capitalists in other cities look at you and say, well, that's terrific, but you know, I'm not getting on a plane from New York to go visit you once I get to move to New York. So my great friends and people that have worked with me for a long time, Justin Osler and his Caldwell, who started a company called Coffitivity as part of the ADN's family, Justin moved to Buffalo, New York, after coming in second in a 17,000-person pitch competition. Second place out of 500,000 dollars. Start and quote, they were not sure to take the capital is really important. Next, the community that gets back. So you can think about that as being people to fund it, right? The earlier on. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about a community that gives back content, that gives back inspiration, that gives back advice, that gives back opportunity. And you have to have community involvement to make this work because the people that have the advice are the people that have gone through it. They need to be involved. And then you. This doesn't really work very well unless you have talented, diverse, imaginative students. Why does diversity matter? Diversity matters because I guarantee you don't have the answer yourself. Diversity matters because different lenses and different orthodoxies play into the creation of ideas and the evaluation of which ones are good and not good. And if you don't have that diversity, you oftentimes miss opportunity and also misjudge risk. That's what really is viewed as being the map for a vibrant, university-engaged entrepreneurial ecosystem. And that is a description of the Stanford and Silicon Valley. In fact, it comes from the study of Stanford and Silicon Valley. Now, we don't have to be Stanford, and we shouldn't aspire to be Silicon Valley. We can be terrific as Richmond, Virginia, but those components still have to be in place. You can't skip. It doesn't work. It hasn't worked anyway. Well, what does that do? So we're talking about building these ecosystems. Does it really matter? I mean, sometimes you look at programs within a university and you might think to yourself, well, I'd be involved. Like, why do we find people in this map? Well, this matters a lot. Why does it matter? Let's look at one example. Let's just look at Stanford. Actually, it's not one. It's $2.7 trillion. The annual revenue is 5.4 million jobs created from graduates of Stanford. In fact, the Stanford entrepreneurs represented and comprised a country. It would be a country with the 10th largest economy on earth out of one university. Staggering numbers. Staggering numbers. But that's just Stanford, right? I mean, Stanford's unusual. Stanford's on the West Coast, it's not Harvard. Stanford is amazing and feels really unusual to us. But let's think about Virginia for a minute. In Virginia, the University of Virginia has done a study in which they went back and polled 22,000 graduates and then did statistical analysis to be able to expand and extrapolate from that data. Based on that research, UVA alumni created approximately 65,000 companies. It estimated 2.3 million people have worked at those companies, and they create global revenues of $1.6 trillion annually. So, pretty close to the 2.6 trillion. Steady business. What's the $1 trillion? These organizations are turning out people who have tremendous productive capability. But it's really not just about entrepreneurs. And this is the tricky part, because you're all here because you have some interest in entrepreneurial activities, I'm guessing. But innovation, if you think about it in a slightly different way, innovation applies in entrepreneurship, it also applies to large companies. And in large companies, innovation takes on a very special prominence because companies have capital, they have distribution, and if you have great innovation in those companies, they can create a lot of jobs. And when you think about it, that startup market, that really early stage company that takes off, for a long time is very, very small compared to the established company. But it has a lot of impact on the established company. What kinds of impact do you think startup might have? Ideas, invention, talented employees. One of the reasons that companies want to locate in any given municipality is because of the level of education and competence, skill, and drive they can get from the community. So there's sort of a circular benefit, because on the other hand, as companies grow and people become skilled, they oftentimes spill out into the community, and they start businesses at that time. Now, many of you are not from the Richmond area. If you were going to start an insurance company in the United States, there are probably two states if you can think about doing that. Probably actually two cities. The first one is Scottsdale, Arizona. And the second one is Richmond, Virginia. Why is that true? One of the reasons it's true is because we've had a number of very successful insurance enterprises that have grown sufficiently that people have spun out and created their own, that have then grown. Kauffman Foundation data suggests that if you create entrepreneurial activity around the deep roots in which your city has become successful, you are more likely to grow an ecosystem. And that's an area where we've been very, very successful. So the large companies spit out small companies, and both the large companies and the small companies need you to help them feel growth. The universities also throw out research. So patents, as an example, come out of the university that's done on VCU commercialization. And there's tremendous intellectual property that comes out of that school. How do we get that into the community? So you can see that these things work together. So what do we do as a community? Because this all sounds great, and we've got components, like we've got you, we've got students, we've got a little bit of government assistance, we've got a little bit of funding, we've got a little bit of this and a little bit of that. We've still got a very small ecosystem. Think of it a little bit like starting a fire. You've got to have some kind of spark. You've got to have some kind of tinder. You've got to have oxygen. Fuel the flames. Here's what those pieces can do in an ecosystem. Universities help you build skills. They create a community. One of the things that's really interesting about the ecosystem of an entrepreneurial community is that there are a lot of collisions. In other words, people bumping into each other, people talking in casual ways. That actually works better than formal habits. That's one of the reasons for the moment class. Because you get people together and they collide, they talk and exchange ideas. Culture, this gets back to the notion of risk-taking, experimental culture. Engage students. So one of my great friends and colleagues who's now in Austin, Texas, has a saying, don't be boring, go do. And that's what you need to do. If you spend 4 years playing FIFA, you're going to not stand out very much when you try to find a job. You spend one semester thinking about a project, you're trying into something like a company, you have stories to tell. Good one. Universities provide funding. So we have a pitch competition coming up in a week at the University of Richmond. You have pitch competitions at VCU. That's one way in which universities provide funding. Another at the University of Richmond is a summer fellowship. So students at the University of Richmond are entitled to one summer, which they get paid by the university for an internship. That internship can be on their own start. So effectively funding. And finally, so the depot at VCU is an example. It's a fabulous location. Those of you from Richmond who haven't been there, it is really a tremendous spot. VCU students, you should use it if you don't go there regularly. State and local federal government. There's so many things that can happen here, and I hope Maurice sneaks into that. So I can talk a little bit to the Secretary of Trade and Commerce about this. Enterprise zones, direct funding to startups. This one's interesting. Saleable tax credits. Most startups don't have any. So tax credits are not very valuable to a lot of people because there's no reason to be able to have a tax credit, except some municipalities are now issuing saleable tax credits. So if you have income, then you can apply the tax credits. But if you don't have income, you can barter or sell your tax credits for the cash to run your business or the services you need. Pretty interesting. Tax abatements, investment tax credits for people that put them into companies. And one that I sold from one of the top urbanists in the world that I've had the pleasure of knowing, a guy named Andres Duwani, are pink tape reforms. What do you think those are? So one of the big problems with government is red tape. This is just a lighter version. It's pink tape. Don't make it so hard to be in business. Take away some of the restrictions. Take away some of the impediments. Things like how you have to outfit a building. We have many, many buildings in the city of Richmond that can be used as a place where you can have your businesses. But because they're so expensive to outfit to code, you might in fact not be able to utilize that business or anything. But architects can go in and certify when the building is safe and be less than code, and you can actually raise your productive use. And finally, industry. Spin-outs that we talked about, direct funding, grants, incubators, all of these things happen. In fact, every major company in Richmond does them. Internships, which many of you might want, and finally, venture funds that come from either the finance community or actually from companies directly. That can actually fill in some of the gap that we talked about in the economy. So we've got a MSA, an area population, 1.3 million, something like that. That's actually fairly small, but we have this concentration of businesses that help us make up for it. But it doesn't solve everything. I'm so glad all of you are here today. I'm so especially so glad to make these few students are. I hope that some of the U students come. Here's the next thing, and probably the most important thing I think we can do. And that's to create ecosystem scale. Did you know that there are about 70,000 students within our drive version? That actually makes us pretty good in the world of students. Charlottesville were a top four, William and Mary were a group franchise entrepreneurship program, are somewhat isolated, but already students from VCU, students from Richmond, students from UVA are coming together. Let's pull in the students from William and Mary, and let's also make sure we reach out to people at VU and also schools like Randolph Dinkin and the community colleges. I happen to be a big believer in the community college system. And there are a lot of really, really brilliant people that have to choose that route, not because they want to, but because of circumstances. That makes them no less smarter, no less inventive. And finally, it's more or less up to you, because you need to get out and get this. This is not going to come to you. We provide a platform for you. The community provides an opportunity for you. But if you don't get out into the community and do this yourself, you will not have success if you want to grow the ecosystem. And I can look around the world. Many of you I know from VCU or from U of R who have businesses here today, Trilogy Mentor, Confluence Coffee. These are things that have come out of these schools. You can do this too. Get this. And if I can ever be of help, here's my contact information. I'm available to you from VCU. I'm available to you from U of R. I'm available to you from anybody in the ecosystem. Thank you very much.
More of the community every day to go to work, and so you can't teach at U of R anymore. And I said, not a risk taker. But what I realized is that I really knew what I wanted to do, which was do something that I was really passionate about. And when my leadership changed, I was no longer passionate about the organization I was working for. So I thought learning hard about some of the work that I've been doing at the bank and decided to start a company and choose a dream. And so even though I was not a risk taker, I took a deep breath. And I should say I had the support of someone at home that said, yes, let's do this together. And we looked at the market and we said, we can either invest our money in real estate, we can invest it in the market, we can invest it in a variety of places. But we said the only known quantity of all of those is us. We know ourselves and our work ethic better than anything else. So let's invest in ourselves. And that's what we did. So the first organization that I built is called the Caregiving, and that came from my work in banking, which was about providing support for aging, for aging adults. So for those of us that have families and parents and grandparents who are getting older, we saw that there was a need to help guide this generation of people to do that. And so we did that, and we've grown. We just won the innovative award leader, from ACSB, which was exciting. And I was teaching full-time, and life was good. But then I also started to find myself hungry to do something new. And I took an exercise class in New York City, and I can say it literally changed my life. I went home and I said, my gosh, I can't believe you don't have this religion, and we have to have it. And so I became hungrily looking for a place to create this same type of exercise system. Now, for those of you coming to the Richmond, there are lots of us. Is Richmond an active city? Very, right? So if you look around the competitive landscape, do we have lots of options in terms of fitness? Yes. So it is a very competitively intense environment in which to enter. So the most important thing in terms of entering the market, any industry, or particularly this one, was about having an ownable point of difference and really thinking hard about how we could separate ourselves, not only from people that do exactly what we do, but also from the CrossFits of the world and from the runners of the world and from the SEAL teams of the world and on and on and on. And so fast forward, we found a location and thought hard about what our ownable point of difference would be. And I think that's the most important thing to mention when you think about a competitive ecosystem, is really understanding what that means and how hard that is to develop. So for us, we are a bar studio. Does anyone here know what bar is? A few. So it's designed to give you the body of a dancer. For ladies, that's an appealing thing. For some gentlemen, too. We have a few gentlemen in our classes, but it's mostly ladies. And, but we needed to know how to protect that, how to build it and protect it. So what we decided to do was to build a relationship with the Richmond Ballet. And so all of our classes are taught by either current or former professional ballet dancers. And so the idea was you can have a very authentic experience as you exercise. Now, for us, that was really important because at the time we got started, there was one other bar studio on the other side of town. Well, does anybody in here read Distance? Christian Distance? If you are running entrepreneurs, you should read it. You should sign up today because it's all of the local news. But for anyone that read it, there is another bar studio that's moving to Richmond soon. It just announced their opening. It's the third of the largest national chain. They have 300 bar studios and more than that now across the country. And so for us, people will say, are you nervous about that? Are you scared about that? And I will say, no, I think that's great. Because number one, it means that there's a market, there's an appetite for this in Richmond, because I guarantee our little company, which has two studios, they have a much bigger network of researchers in terms of real estate and demographics and demands than we do. So there's still an appetite in Richmond for more. But also, it forces us to really galvanize that vulnerable point of difference. It makes us all more competitive. So what they have to offer is something different than what we have to offer. And so I think as an entrepreneur, and particularly as an entrepreneur in a very crowded space, understanding what your ownable point of difference is the most important thing you can do. But it's also the best thing that you can do in terms of encouraging competition. Because as more people enter the market, it becomes better for our customers and it forces us to be better as well. Now, I would say that because from a personal storytelling point of view, it's difficult for us because it's a limiting factor. There are only so many professional dancers in the world, and certainly in Richmond. So as we grow, that has limited our ability to get scale the way some of these other professionals have. So from our personal little neck of the woods, I think in terms of developing a competitive ecosystem here in Richmond, having that really strong, vulnerable point of difference and communicating it really well is the most important thing you can do. And I think that we see it not just in our industry, but in others as well. The restaurant industry here in Richmond is wonderful. We have lots of local finding the right markets to open your small business in. And I think Richmond is a great market to be in business, particularly as a small self-funded startup, because some of the points that were made earlier, we have a market that's really willing to wrap their arms around people and allow us to take risks. We were able to open a business, we were self-funded, we were completely brand new to the fitness scene, we were not in the quantity. And Richmond is a place that you can do that. So finding a city that is supported and a community of people who are willing to try you out, I think is incredibly important as well. In terms of other things of our own little part of the world, I think having an appetite for risk taking is very important. It's important to know that you have to do what you love, because it's always going to be twice as expensive at least, and twice as much work at least, to undergo and execute an activity like this. If I didn't love this business, there's no way I could possibly do it, because at the end of the day of teaching all day and reading papers and submitting grades, then it's time to work on client emails and developing new plans for the business. So it's important that you understand not only what makes you different, but why you're going to stay true to that difference, and how it keeps you going every day, because the love of that organization is what has to keep you going every day. So that's our little story, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you all have about our business or where we came from, or why we chose Richmond, or anything. Yes?
What's the name of the bar?
We are the Bar Boutique. Yes, and so our major competition in Richmond, since we're talking about competitive infrastructure, we started with another local company, it's called Richmond Bar, and they were excellent. They were full all the time. I couldn't get into a class, but it was kind of on the other side of town. And I went to the class in New York City, and I said, why isn't this in more places in Richmond? And I noticed some of the weaknesses of what the offering was here in Richmond. That company has since exited the market, but since that time, since we opened, Pure Bar has come into play. They're a national chain. They now are going to operate their third location here in Richmond. And then we have Corner Bar that has a location in Short Pump. And we have a new player in Logan. We're also in Logan called Gallery Bar. So it's becoming more competitive all the time. And now the ACACs of the world and the Gold's Gyms of the world and the YMCAs of the world are also offering it. So for us to be able to say, yes, you can take a class anywhere, but with us, you're going to take it from a professionally trained ballet dancer. That's a good thing. That's our own point of difference. And I really believe that the more people that offer our classes, it forces us to be better. So in terms of developing